Good morning. So good to see you today. Thank you for coming. We want to especially welcome our visitors. We're just commenting that not only did Diane and Charlie have birthdays this week, they also are winning the trophy for Pack a Pew Sunday. Yeah. Wow. Entire family's here, and we're thankful for that. Hope you all have a blessed Lord's Day with us. And we hope you all have a good Lord's Day. Announcements. Next Sunday, the 11th, I'll be preaching a short message, and then the rest of the service will be devoted to a question-answer session with Pearson Johnson III and Rick Altizer, who are candidates for our positions of associate pastor or pastor for part-time pastor for administration, which would be Rick, and part-time pastor for discipleship, which would be Pearson. He and Amy are away on a little vacation today. So that's what we'll do next Sunday. After that question-answer session, we will call a business meeting, and we will have a vote to call those two men to those positions here at White Oak Baptist Church. Lord willing, the following Sunday, part of that morning service will be an installation service in which we will formally install them as pastors, elders, overseers of this church. And if you're interested in the positions, we have job descriptions that are in the lobby on the table right behind this wall. And you all know these men very well. They've been with the church for years. And I believe this is a good next step for White Oak Baptist. And I'm praying that the church will concur. But it's ultimately your call, because we are Baptists and we really believe in congregational form of government. All right, in other news, an ice cream social, Saturday night, 6 p.m. All right, the church is going to provide the ice cream, we're going to provide some toppings, we're going to provide some kind of drink, probably water, which is good. If you come, if you can you bring a plate of cookies, can you bring a plate of finger desserts, or if you have a super duper topping that you love, bring that too. Bring anything you want. It's an ice cream social, and there's no program involved. We're just going to get together on a warm August evening and enjoy some ice cream together down in the fellowship hall. So please come. I hope you really do avail yourself of that. You can see about our next life groups. And I also want to call your attention to Community Bible Study, which meets here in our church. It is not officially affiliated with White Oak, but it is a wonderful, wonderful women's Bible study that we are very supportive of. And you can read that announcement that they're open for business here on August 22nd, and they're going to be studying Philemon, 1st, 2nd, 3rd, John, Jude, and Revelation during the course of the year. We have some new Bible verses for memory this week. If you'll turn to the back panel of your bulletin, we're memorizing selected verses from our book of Ephesians, which is our study for the immediate future. I'll read the reference, we'll read the verses together, and we'll all repeat the reference, okay? Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we ask or think, according to the power at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Ephesians 3, 20 and 21. I'll ask Rick to come and lead us in our opening song.
Let's stand together. Please be seated.
As we go to prayer, Rebecca is not with us today. Her mother was admitted to the hospital emergency room on advice of her doctors. So let's pray for Rebecca King's mom. And they are at the hospital. This morning I received a text from Rebecca that she is there in the emergency room with her mother and that they're going over medical records. She has something with her liver. It looks like an infection that has attacked her liver and caused a high white blood count, things like that. So let's pray for Rebecca's mom at this time. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we pray for our sister Sue Steveson. We pray that you'd bless her in this time of medical crisis. And we pray for Rebecca, who's been so faithful to take care of her aging parents. And we pray that you give her comfort and strength. And as a church, help us to gather around her and her family, lift them up in prayer and in support. And we pray that you might restore her to complete health. Father, we thank you for the group that's with us today. We thank you for bringing us to this point where we are with God's people and we're sitting under the teaching of God's word because the Lord of glory, Jesus Christ, is our Savior. We thank you for the book of Ephesians, what it's teaching us about who we are in Christ, and help us to understand how we must behave as a basis, on the basis of that identity in Christ. And Father, we thank you that you have created us for good works, that you ordained before the foundation of the world that we should walk in them. And I pray, Father, that we might walk humbly, that we might walk in faith, that we might walk circumspectly, that we might walk in wisdom, that we might walk in love. And Father, help us to exemplify who we are in Christ to a world that so desperately needs him. Father, we thank you for those who are away from us today, traveling, getting some vacation time. We pray that you give them safety, refreshment, bring them back to us as soon as is possible. I pray again for our shut-ins, those who would love to be with us but cannot. I pray that they would receive great blessing on this Lord's Day and help them to know how much they are loved and missed. I thank you, Father, for Jesus Christ, the righteous one, who died for our sins according to the Scriptures, who was buried and rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. And we thank you, Father, that in his name is salvation and in his name only is redemption. Father, we pray that today we would honor him, and we pray, Father, that we would be humbled under your word, that you might lift us up. And Father, the joy of the Lord is our strength. Help us to be a joyful people. How can we be anything but joyful when we recognize who and what we are in Jesus Christ and what Christ has done for us? And we thank you for the creature comforts that you afford to us, that we're in an air-conditioned building, that we're safe and free from political interference that might disrupt this service. We thank you that you've given us the freedom to proclaim the gospel in this country. We pray that that might continue. But Father, help us to take advantage of that freedom. Help us to do all that we can to make Christ known and that we might proclaim his kingdom and his truth and that we might also proclaim it in the way that we live. Now, Father, I commit everything about this service to your hands, and we pray every week that you will accomplish the purposes for which you have intended this service to exist, because we ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Thank you.
Great singing.
If you're looking at your bulletins this morning, you're supposed to see Sam Lewis up here, but he's not feeling well today. And so he sent me his prayer, and I would love to share his prayer with you this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, those of us who have accepted Jesus into our hearts understand the peace and comfort of knowing that we will spend eternity with you one day. We are here this morning and have come to worship you and to learn more about you so that we can become more like you. We fail you often, yet your grace and your mercy and your kindness and your goodness rest upon us. We are so grateful for all that you have given to us and blessed us with. So, we freely and willfully give back to you. We ask for your blessings on the offering and on this service this morning. May the Holy Spirit give our pastor the words to say, and may our hearts be receptive to them. May we go away from here changed people. For it is in the holy name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 95, beginning with verse 1. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand.
next song.
Thank you for your good singing. Turn please in your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. Our focus will be on verses 1 through 10. Let's read verses 1 through 16 for context, all right? Ephesians chapter 4. I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you have been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope that belongs to your call, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all, and through all, and in all. But grace was given to each one of us according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore it says, when he ascended on high, he led a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. In saying he ascended, what does it mean but that he had also descended into the lower regions of the earth? He who descended is the one who also ascended far above all the heavens, that he might fill all things. And he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, and teachers to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ, until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful schemes. Rather, speaking the truth in love, we are to grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and held together by every joint with which it is equipped, when each part is working properly, makes the body grow so that it builds itself up in love. Just some opening observations. We're now in chapter 4. As we have said previously, the book of Ephesians can be divided relatively neatly into two segments. Chapters 1, 2, and 3 present great doctrinal truths about who we are in Christ, our position in Christ, what Christ has done for us, what it means to be a body. Chapters 4, 5, and 6, then, is the working out of that truth. And the great truths of chapter 4 through 6 talk about our walk as one in Christ. The great truth of chapters 1, 2, 3 is God has made us one in Christ. So we're now entering into the phase of this book where we're talking about how to walk that out. Now, we should not make a vast distinction between these two units as if they're totally separate from each other. You might put it this way. Chapters 1, 2, and 3 are indicative. In the Greek, that means it's an identification of something that is. This is who we are in Jesus Christ. Chapters 4, 5, and 6 tend to be imperatives. Based on who you are in Christ, now let's walk that way. Let's walk in accordance with who we really are. Let's review our major key themes of this book. I'm borrowing this, frankly, from the ESV Study Bible. I thought it was very helpful. Theme number one is that all people are by nature spiritually dead. We saw that, did we not? That people disobey God's law and that they tend to be ruled by Satan apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. Prior to our salvation, we were in really bad shape. Theme two is that God has predestined his people to redemption and holiness in Christ. We have been redeemed for purposes, and those purposes include being redeemed as a people of God, united by the Holy Spirit in one body that is indeed the body of Christ. A third theme is that God's rich mercy in Christ has saved these sinners. This free gift is by grace through faith alone. The dominant theme of those first three chapters is we are new creations in Christ Jesus by faith alone, by grace alone. There's a fourth theme. Jesus' saving work was part of redeeming a fallen creation for God. For this, he deserves glory, honor, and authority in this age and in the age to come. Jesus unites Jews and Gentiles into one body, the church, which is a new creation, a new thing, essentially a new race. And Christ's people are saved to new lives of holiness in thought, in word, in deed. They must reject their old sinful lifestyles, as chapter 4 begins to tell us. Another theme is that holiness in life includes submission to proper authorities in home, in family life, and those in authority must care for those in submission to them. And finally, Jesus has given powerful gifts to his church. These bring unity, maturity, and defense against the devil and his allies. Anybody here watching the Olympics? I watch the Olympics. I am a recovering sports addict, I suppose. I love to watch the Olympics. I love characters who show up in the Olympics. The guy on the pommel horse who looks like he came to fix your computer. That guy, you see him? Or the Turkish guy in the shooting. I mean, the guy has these little yellow earplugs. Everybody else has got all this gear. He's got a t-shirt that says Turkey on it, puts his hand in his pocket, doesn't even close one eye, just kind of go, poof. He looks like a hired killer, you know, with these glasses on. Just these characters show up. But what impresses me most about the Olympics is it's the culmination of years of diligent practice at something. They worked at this. It is not by happenstance that they're going to be on a medal stand, nor is it by happenstance that they're going to compete at the highest levels, the highest echelons of their sport. It is the culmination, basically, of doing that which is essential every single day. It is majoring on the basics. It is taking the skill set one step at a time. It is indeed a working out of an ability that has been given by God to the highest level humanly possible. That's what Ephesians 4, 5, and 6 really is about. It is who you are by the grace of God, your giftedness by the grace of God, worked out day after day, moment by moment, with the culmination being you are going to eventually be like Christ. And we make a huge distinction between these two units to our peril. We do it like this. We want to rush to judgment in our seminars about family, about work relationships, about marriage. And we want to go immediately to chapters 4, 5, and 6 to find the answers there, as if chapters 1, 2, and 3 were not even under consideration. Folks, you're not going to have the kind of Christian marriage that Paul describes in chapters 5 and 6 if you are not grounded in who you are on the basis of chapters 1, 2, and 3. It is who you are in Christ that is going to manifest itself and work itself out in your life as parents, as children, as employers, as employees, as members of churches, as pastors of churches. But we also had to realize the command to walk worthy of our calling is an amazing command. Now think about this. If you've been paying attention to chapters 1, 2, and 3, you're like, wow. I mean, if you're like I am, your mind has been blown. Has anybody's mind kind of been blown by what we've been talking about here? Mine has, and I'm preaching on this stuff. It's absolutely mind-blowing. And then Paul comes up with this amazing statement, I therefore, as a prisoner, I'm urging you to walk in a manner worthy of that calling. Yikes! Who's going to be able to do that? He can tell us that we can walk worthy of this calling, even though the salvation that we have is almost indescribable in its magnificence. How can we as mere mortals ever hope to live up to a call that is involved in our position in Christ and our eternal possessions through Christ? We can do so because even though this worthy walk is an incredible command that involves walking in gentleness, walking in patience, walking in humility, walking in wisdom, walking in love. We can do these things because the Lord Jesus Christ has saved you for those purposes. And one of the anchor points you take from chapters 1, 2, and 3 is this. You have been saved by grace alone, right? We are saved by grace through faith, not of our works, lest any man should boast. For we are his what? Workmanship, poema, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which he ordained that we should walk in. When you live for Christ, you are doing that which, in a sense, is spiritually necessary. And by necessary, I mean it's the next thing that's going to happen. It is a living out of who you are. Yeah, the commands are amazing. Patience is hard. Forbearance is really hard. Humility is wow. We get that. But the grace of God is better. The grace of God is bigger. The grace of God is more powerful. And we're not entering into three chapters about grace and three chapters about work. We're talking about six chapters of grace. That's what we're talking about. The grace to live out the truths that identify you as a born-again Christian. Let's take a first look at this calling to a worthy walk. We are called to a worthy walk. Now, this is Paul talking. He describes himself as a prisoner for the Lord, and he's urging us to walk in a manner worthy of this calling. But what are some presuppositions we bring to this? What does Paul already have in mind? He already has in mind what Christ has done for us, or what God has done for us through the Spirit in Christ. Just listen. We aren't going over the verses again, but just pay attention. He chose us. He planned that we should be blameless before him. He predestinated us. He adopted us. God accepted us in his Son. God redeemed us by Christ's blood. God forgave us of our sins. God lavished his grace on us. God gave us an inheritance. God gave us the Holy Spirit. God gave us his power. God gave us his knowledge. God gave us life when we were dead. God made us his workmanship. God gave us access. God has given us peace. God gave us citizenship in heaven. God made us his children in his family. God revealed to us the mystery of his will. God placed in us placed us in his Son. God has seated us in the heavenly realms, and God is making us a dwelling place for himself. That's just 22 things that we learned in chapters 1 through 3. And Paul says, I want you to walk worthy of that. Well, there's two great truths that I think are going on here. God has created the church in Christ, and God has unified his church in the Spirit. This passage really is about unity. It's about us being made one in Christ, one body in Christ, living in accordance with that truth. Now, walking worthy is an interesting phrase. The word worthy there does have a word picture of a scale, a balance. And the idea is the scale should be balanced, but we tend to look at this in a false way. We tend to look at it in a legalistic way. If I do all these really good works over here, it will somehow weigh as much as the grace I've been given. I mean, it's never going to happen. You can't bring human effort to this level that it's ever going to balance in accordance with the 22 things plus others that I didn't read that we have on the side of grace. What are your puny works going to do? They're not going to balance the scale. God balances the scale by then taking those 22 plus things, making them operative in your life, making them real to you, and then you go out and live according to what God is doing in you. And then the scales are indeed balanced. You're walking in a way that actually declares who you are in Christ. But also, God has unified his church. He urges us to walk in a manner worthy, and that worthy manner takes into account the concept of unity. God has unified his church in the Spirit. Now, we do not create the unity. We are united. God has united us in his Son by his Spirit. And we are called then, as a part of this worthy walk, to maintain the unity that already exists. In essence, the entire book of Ephesians is a book about how to walk according to the reality of who you are. And much of this corporate walk is something that we do together, not just individually. You say, well, how can I walk worthy of the calling that I have in Christ Jesus? One of the ways that God has provided is this. He's given you fellow believers in Jesus Christ to walk worthily alongside you, to encourage you. I was watching the decathlon finals. And I can't remember what country the winner was from. Norway? I can't remember. Is it Norway? Norway. Well, the last race they run is the 1,500 meters, basically the Olympic mile. It's the most grueling thing. It's the last thing they do after 2 days of intense competition in 10 disciplines. The decathlete. You know, it's a decathlete. And basically, informally, this person is considered to be the greatest athlete in the world at this time because he can do all these things. Well, they're running the 1,500. Well, the guy who's going to win the decathlon doesn't have to win the 1,500. He just has to finish in front of the guy from Germany, right? And so he's running along, but his teammate, who's not really in the competition, is running ahead of him, the 1,500. And there are times when he turns around, almost turns his back on the field, and is just barking at the guy who eventually wins. Come on! Come on! You can do it! You can do it! You can do it! Let's go! Let's go together! And he helped this guy move along to the point where he did win the decathlon, one of the most prestigious events in all of the Olympics. Part of the winning was a teammate who's going along beside him, encouraging, exhorting, challenging. Folks, we need each other desperately to walk in a manner worthy of our calling. And our country, I've said it so many times, I love the United States, but one of the downsides of being an American is we have such individualism ingrained in us through our culture that we drag it into the church where it never belongs. You are in this together. We are corporately, as a body of believers, to spur each other on to love and to good works. But let's notice the position of this guy who calls us. This is Paul, speaking through the Holy Spirit. He describes himself as a prisoner of the Lord. This could be translated, perhaps better translated, a prisoner in the Lord. We've already talked about this. Paul says, you are in Christ, I am in Christ, and part of my being in Christ is that now, temporarily, I'm in jail. I'm a prisoner in Christ Jesus. And he's also a prisoner for the sake of the gospel. And he's a prisoner for the sake of these Ephesians. As a pastor, as a preacher, as an evangelist, Paul loves these folks. And that's demonstrated not just in his position here, but also his passion. What is he saying? He passionately desires that his spiritual children maintain a worthy walk. He says, I urge you to walk. And the word urge there has the idea of exhort, entreat. And it's the idea of calling to one side. It's a heart cry. I beg you. I encourage you. I entreat you. This is really important. Now, folks, you must never despise, ignore, or shrug off the pleadings of godly spiritual leaders who care for your souls. It's part of walking humbly. So this prisoner in the Lord is urging these people to walk in a manner that's worthy of their calling. Let's look secondly at the character of this walk. What is this walk supposed to be like? Our walk corresponds to our calling. This whole worthiness, as I said, reflects an equality, a balancing of the scale. But I love what Martin Lloyd-Jones said about this. He said, think of two things which are of the same weight, so that when you put them up on opposite sides of the scale, there is no tilting to one side or the other, but they balance perfectly. That is the original derivation of the word translated here by worthy. So what the apostle is saying is that he is beseeching them and exhorting them always to give equal weight in their lives to doctrine and practice. They must not put all the weight on doctrine and none on practice, nor all the weight on practice and just a little, if any, at all on doctrine. To do so produces imbalance and lopsidedness. The Ephesians must take great pains to see that the scales are perfectly balanced. However packed your head may be with knowledge, if you are failing in your life, you will be a hindrance to the spreading of the kingdom, and you will bring the cause of God and his Christ into disrepute. But it is equally true to say that if your conception of the Christian life is that it means no more than that you live a good life, that you should be moral, and that doctrine is of no importance, again, you will be a hindrance to the cause. There must be true balance. We must be worthy of the vocation wherewith we are called. That's the character. What are the consequences of this kind of calling? Our walk is a consequence of the call. It is not something that comes out of just whole cloth. And that causes us to seriously ponder what is in chapters 1, 2, and 3 as we have. And we should seriously ponder other passages that have to do with this concept of calling. Now, the word is sometimes translated vocation in the King James, but you must not think of it as the way you make your living, as an accountant, as a lawyer, as a teacher, as a factory worker, as a homemaker. Those are vocational in one sense. When the New Testament talks about vocation or calling, it's talking about your calling in Christ Jesus. Romans 11:29, Paul says of this calling, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. King James says, without repentance. Now, the context of Romans 11, he's talking to the Gentiles about the Jews, and he's basically saying, in essence, don't think the Jews have been totally left out of God's future, because God has said his calling is without repentance. It is irrevocable. Your call in Christ Jesus is irrevocable. No one's going to take it back. How about 1 Corinthians 1, verse 26, Paul says, for consider your calling. Give serious thought to your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many were powerful. Not many were of noble birth. What's Paul's insistence there? You were not called on the basis of something about you naturally. In other words, you might be here the child of a king. You might be a literal prince or princess. I don't know. I have my doubts. You could be. But it makes no difference in terms of your calling. Most people who are called are just people, regular, ordinary people. Paul also says in Ephesians 1:18, we've already looked at this passage weeks ago, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which you have been, he has called you. What are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints? Part of knowing this calling is to understand how rich it is. And you have to have the eyes of your heart enlightened to grasp those truths. I love 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Paul says to the Thessalonians, to this end, we always pray for you. He's a good pastor. That our God may make you worthy of his calling and may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by his power. Did you get that? You say, how am I supposed to walk worthy of the calling? Paul gives us the answer in 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. Let's read it again. To this end, we always pray for you that our God may make you worthy of his calling. And our God may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by his power. My prayer is not that you'll just do good works. My prayer is that you will be surrendered to the point where God is doing this good work through you. And verse 12 says, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Folks, this puts an end to mere bootstrap theology. Now let's face it. Much of life is packing your lunchbox and going to work. Is it not? I always have an image in my head about work. And the image in my head, I may have shared before, is my dad's old black lunchbox, the kind that had the lid with the dome and you put the thermos in there and all that. And he would bring it home. Sometimes he'd bring a candy bar for the kids, whatever. That's my ongoing image of what it means to go to work. You do it every day, and you just keep on doing it. There is a diligence here. But what we do every day and how we are being diligent is an example of what God is doing through you. You say, well, Pastor, you've stressed this for weeks and weeks and weeks, and I will stress it for weeks to come. This is something God is doing in and through you. That does not mean you sit on the sofa and watch the Olympics all day and hope something good happens. It means that you are to exercise this giftedness, and while exercising this giftedness, God is actually at work in you and through you to the glory of God every single day. Paul says to Timothy in 2 Timothy 1:9, that he saved us and called us to a holy calling, not because of our works, but because of his own purpose and grace, which he gave us in Christ Jesus before the ages began. You're part of the picture, and the picture is eternal, and the picture is grand. But Peter does tell us in 2 Peter, a very famous verse, after he tells us to add to our faith knowledge, and to knowledge virtue, and to virtue, you know, that whole list of things. He says, therefore, brothers, be all the more diligent to confirm your calling and election. For it is if you practice these qualities, you will never fall. Folks, it's the already not yet principle. It is the already not yet principle. You are already in Christ Jesus, seated with Christ Jesus in the heavenly realms. And that calling is irrevocable. But you're also here in the old nasty now and now, the daily grind, so to speak. And you're here working out that calling through daily consistency of life, empowered by the Spirit and encouraged by the truth that the good works you're doing were ordained by God that you should do them. And if God ordained that you should do them, it's just simple logic. You can do them. Now, what is this worthy walk like? Look at verses 2 through 10. We can't go through these with any great sense of completeness. Component number one of this holy, worthy walk is humility. You're to walk, verse 2, with all humility. And this word means what it says. It's humble. It's having a humble opinion of yourself. It's having a deep sense of one's moral smallness. It's having modesty, humility, having a lowliness of mind. And is not this contrary to the way the world talks, the way the world thinks, the way the world speaks? But it's necessary if we're going to properly value those who come along beside us, the others around us. Because without this humility, it could be that you puff yourself up, that you try to become the actual head, which is a position reserved only for Jesus Christ. There's a second one, closely linked, with all humility and gentleness, sometimes translated meekness. It's a mildness. Now, it's not a quality of weakness. It is, in essence, power under control. We know that Moses, the great, great prophet and leader of Israel, was described as a meek man, the meekest of men. And Jesus Christ describes his own heart as being meek and lowly. The question we have to put to ourselves, does that describe you and me? Are we humble? Are we meek? You say, well, that's hard. Wait a minute. Number three, patience. Humility, gentleness with patience. It's the idea of forbearance, long-suffering, slowness in avenging wrongs. This phrase could legitimately be translated as put up with one another in love. You just put up with it. You endure it because you're patient. Folks, the body is made up of all kinds of people, right? Let's take a look around this room. There's some odd ducks in here, I'm telling you. Yeah, there they are. We've got all kinds of folks in this church. And that means all kinds of quirks, and it means all kinds of proclivities, it means all kinds of problems. And maintaining unity is possible when we are willing to endure with each other's imperfections and each other's growth. Because let's play it out. You got people in the church who might have less than stellar efforts at being gentle and meek. Hello, me. And it's not that we put up with it in the sense that we just shrug it off. We help each other with that imperfection. Right? We come alongside. We help each other knowing that there's something that they can see that perhaps we don't see. That's followed up by a similar term in our ESV. It's called forbearance, if you will. Bearing with one another in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit. Forbearance is the idea of bearing up under it. You're eager to keep this thing going. It's not something that you simply do in a half-hearted manner. And what makes long-suffering and forbearance possible? The following virtue, which is love. So with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another, which is forbearance, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. What's that mean? It's love. It's love. Bearing with one another in love. You know, Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 13, the great love chapter, love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. So when we get put out with other people in the flock, When we get out of sorts with people in the family, quite often that is an indication that we're not loving as we should. When you love people, you will be humble, meek, lowly, forbearing, and patient. I love how Paul puts it in Colossians 3, how this love is so central. He says, "Put on then as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another. And if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other, as the Lord has forgiven you, so also you must forgive. And above all these, put on," say it with me, "love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony." How are we doing, folks? In the category of love, is it binding us together in perfect harmony? Is it causing us to be more kind, more humble, more compassionate? Is it helping us to have kindness and humility and meekness and patience? Sometimes it's not the central problem we try to tackle. We try to tackle the outliers, we try to tackle the symptoms. The question is, do you love? And that's going to be the ultimate test of Ephesians 1, 2, and 3. When you understand who you are in Christ, and you understand the amazing love of God for you in Christ Jesus, then you come to recognize that we love because He loved. And folks, as 1 John, an entire epistle, was written to attack this or deal with this, if we don't have love for our brothers and sisters in Christ, there is very little evidence that we know Jesus Christ. It's that important. It's that important. And are you not struck with this? All right, Paul, Ephesians 1, 2, and 3. Now we're going to walk worthy. Here, let's strap, get my boots on, tighten my belt. I'm going to go and not chew, not smoke, not date girls who do. I'm going to go this and this and this and this. And no, what Paul starts off is, where's your meekness? Where's your humility? Where's your patience? Where's your long-suffering? In essence, where's your love? He starts with this manifestation set of chapters with unity and love. That's where he starts, because they're so foundational. Maybe you've heard of the Chinese evangelist and subsequently Chinese martyr, Watchman Nee. Wrote a lot of commentaries. He was of a Brethren background in China. He told a very interesting story about this. So there's this man who lives on a hillside in China. And as you perhaps know, when you live on these hillsides in China, you farm on a terraced capacity. So you have these rice paddies that are planted on the terraces, and the source of the water is at the bottom of the hill. They got to work the water up. And so all these people have these hand-operated water wheels that lift water from the river all the way up to where they are. Well, he always had to lift this water up past a neighbor who had the terrace below him. His neighbor had to do the same thing, but this farmer had to lift the water even higher to reach his own field. So there's this one day, he had to work very hard, get his water up there, on top of the hill, to flood his two fields. And as usual, he went to bed very tired. The next morning, he found that a hole had been dug between the dividing wall separating his neighbor's fields from his, and all his water drained down into his neighbor's fields. Basically, his neighbor had stolen his water. He used this Christian's work for his own benefit, greatly wronged this man. So this Christian, he's trying to live like Christ. He patches up the wall. He works very hard. He floods the fields again, finds that the neighbor has redug the hole in the wall, and the water is drained down to his neighbor's fields. It's happened three or four times. So one day, The Christian is in the village with other Christians at the church, and he's telling them a story. He said, I'm just trying to be patient. I'm trying to live rightly, but maybe something has to be done. Maybe I need to confront my neighbor. Maybe this isn't the way. So this group of Christians prayed. One of the men of the church said, if we only try to do what is the right thing, surely we are very poor Christians. We have to do something more than what is right. This Christian said that maybe it isn't enough just to do the minimum. So the farmer took this to heart and thought about what he could do. So the next day he got up to work with his hand-operated water wheel, and he re-diverted his trough so that his work flooded his neighbor's fields first. When he's finished watering his neighbor's fields, he flooded his own. Later, this neighbor comes to the farmer, wants to know, why did you do this? This is amazing. And this allowed the Christian to tell his neighbor about Jesus Christ. And Watchman Nee says, some weeks later, this man came to know the Lord. Folks, that's what love does. It goes above and beyond. We're so worried about our rights. We're so worried about when we've been wronged. And there are times when things need to be made right, and there are times when restitution is necessary. We're not talking about that. But folks, Jesus Christ said to those Jews, when a Roman soldier compels you, as he has the right to do, to carry his cloak for a mile, what do? With that burden, you carry it what? 2 miles. Not because you have to, because you lovingly want to. You go above and beyond. And this is why Paul's command is so amazing. You want to outdo each other? You want to be in this Olympic race of life? Paul says, here's one way. Let's outdo each other in love. Let's get on, all of us, on the gold medal stand for love. Let's love each other in ways that we did not even conceive to be possible to love each other. And not just fulfill that which is right, but fulfill the law of Christ. There are other things that characterize this. Diligence. We're supposed to be eager to maintain what? The unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. The virtues of our calling in Christ are given to us by God in Christ, but it takes diligence to maintain them. I'm not in any way dismissing that. But this diligence is sustained by remembering we were created for good works and that God ordained in eternity past that we're going to walk in these good works. And so this need for great effort, as Paul uses a word that means to exert oneself, to endeavor, to give diligence, to go above and beyond. And we're supposed to go above and beyond what? Being more externally holy than the ones in our church? Well, not necessarily. We're supposed to go above and beyond to maintain the unity of the Spirit in this bond of peace. Another characteristic is that unity. We will not take the time to expound on all these things. Believe me, we're almost done. But Paul says amazing things here. There's a sevenfold statement about unity. What does he say? Verse 4, there is one body. That's the church. You're it. There is one body, the body of Christ made up of believers. There is one Spirit, and he's talking here about the Holy Spirit. There is one hope. There is one Lord. There is one faith. There's only one baptism, and there's only one God. So we have God, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Spirit as a part of this sevenfold unity. Folks, we are already unified. And as a sidebar, there is no other unity apart from this kind of unity. So Paul goes to the extreme in saying, we are of one body, we have one Spirit, the Holy Spirit, who's baptized us into one hope, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and this is all a part of one God's work who is above all and through all and in all. Folks, unity is not just ice cream socials. I like ice cream socials. But the ice cream social can be a means through which we maintain the unity in the bond of peace by loving each other. The final characteristic of this calling is giftedness. What does he say? There's one God, but grace was given to each one according to the measure of Christ's gift. Now, let's talk about ascension and descension. There's much ink spilt here. I think basically what's happening is Paul is saying the same Christ who came to earth ascended. He descended to the earth, did his work, his high priestly work, then he ascended. And when he ascended, he gave gifts to men. Now, our passage specifically talks about the gifts to the church of the offices. We'll talk about that next week. But there's also other kinds of gifts. The triune God gives us these spiritual gifts. Every believer has at least one spiritual gift. They are permanently bestowed. They're not just talents. And they're given so that the body might be one. Now, is all this all hunky-dory and great and loving? Well, it should be in some senses. But remember what we talked about last time. All of us are getting older. And in this life, getting older means a certain degeneration of the faculties, the ability to walk, to hear, to see sometimes, and sometimes even to think. But Paul says this body is indeed wasting away, but the spirit is growing stronger. And folks, there's nothing in this life that Satan can throw at you that is going to thwart the work of Jesus Christ in you. There is nothing Satan can bring to you that can keep the church from advancing, and you can live in peace, and you can live in harmony, and you can walk in humility, and you can walk in love, and you can fulfill the law of Christ, and you can maintain the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. It is all doable because God has ordained it, and nothing can stop it, and Satan can't thwart it. I've made reference to Corrie Ten Boom. Some of you read her works. She was in a Nazi death camp at Ravensbrück. Roll call came at 4:30 every morning. Most mornings were cold. Sometimes the women were forced to stand without moving for hours in bone-chilling pre-dawn darkness. Nearby were the punishment barracks where all day and far into the night could come the sounds of cruelty, blows, landing in regular rhythm, screams keeping pace. But Corrie and her sister Betsy had a Bible. And at every opportunity they would gather the women together like orphans around a blazing fire and read Romans 8. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? In all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. Corrie later said, I would look about us, as Betsy read, watching the light leap from face to face. More than conquerors. It was not a wish, it was a fact. We knew it. We experienced it minute by minute in an ever-widening circle of help and hope. Life at Ravensbrück took place on two separate levels. One, the observable external life, grew every day more horrible. The other, the life we live with God, grew daily better, truth upon truth, glory upon glory. The Nazi regime cannot quench or destroy the faith of the Lord Jesus Christ and his saints. There is nothing, nothing, absolutely nothing that can separate you from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. And the life that Paul asks us to live is a life that is livable, and nothing can stop it. Nothing can thwart it. Nothing can turn it aside. You will not be conquerors. You are conquerors. And the Olympics are in doubt. Favorites sometimes lose. Former gold medalists sometimes fall. Sometimes great athletes are disqualified. But the life that God has ordained for you will result in glory, because God has ordained it and he will bring it to pass. Let's pray. Father, a lot going on in this passage that we couldn't possibly expound on in the time we have. We just praise you for the word. I thank you for the unity that I've seen in this church. These folks love each other, and they show it in so many wonderful ways every day. And Father, the love that's been shown to me is just beyond measure. Father, we pray that you would conform us to the image of your dear Son, and that you would continue to do works of righteousness and grace and glory through us as we go through our daily lives. And Father, may we endeavor, strive, do all that we can to complete the good work that you have already ordained in us and through us, because we ask it in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Stand, please. We'll sing one verse. We'll be on our way. If I can be of any help to you, please come and see me after the service. We'd love to talk with you about the Lord Jesus Christ, and I hope that you have a blessed day in the Lord. Let's sing. God bless you all. Have a wonderful afternoon.